The mall, a staple in the American pastime since the mid-20th century. Though some still thrive today in all their retail glory, others have fallen to the rise of our technology. So grab a hot pretzel and find a hard bench on which to relax, underneath a beautiful enclosed facade. And join me as we discuss the history of malls. Hello, and welcome to the first episode of The History of Malls. I'm Sean, and if you're here for the history aspect, the nostalgia, or you just thought this was going to be the most ridiculous podcast, welcome, and I'm glad you've joined me. First, let me give you a little background on how this podcast is set up. For myself, I grew up in the mall. I was an 80s and 90s kid, and some of my best, worst, and weirdest memories are at the mall, which I will bring up from time to time as the episodes unfold. Every week, I will pick a new mall to focus on throughout America and delve as deep as I can into its history. I will also choose a store to give history about that was located in that mall. So with that said, let's enjoy this credit card draining memory together. In this first episode, I would like to start off with pretty much the first enclosed mall in America. There were plenty of shopping centers before this one, but this one was in the style of the malls we grew up in, I grew up in. The Southdale Center is located in Edina, Minnesota, and it opened October 8, 1956. The mall was built on 84 acres, was about 7 miles away from downtown Minneapolis, and cost $20 million to build. As of today, it has almost 1.3 million square feet of retail area. When it opened, they had over 40,000 visitors. The courtyard inside the mall has a ton of flowers and was called, quote, Garden Court of Perpetual Spring. They even had a bunch of canaries inside singing. It seemed like it was quite an atmosphere to be in. There were 70 stores with 4 floors. That's a very tall mall. 2 anchor stores. And the big deal about this mall is that it was completely air conditioned and stayed 75 degrees year round. Side note, when I was looking up info on the opening, I found a wanted ad in the paper. So this was 1956, and it was titled Root Sales. The description said, quote, immediate opening for young married man between 20 and 35. Must have chauffeur's license. Previous sales experience helpful, but not necessary. Good starting salary, steady employment. And this was an ad for a company called Bambi Bakery. Just thought it was great how you need to be young, married, and a chauffeur's license, which not really sure what that is. I'm wondering if that's like a class A for truck drivers. They just called it that. But anyway, back to the mall. I would like to talk about the architect named Victor Gruen. Gruen was born in Vienna, Austria in 1903. There he went to Vienna's Academy of Fine Arts and studied architecture and opened his own business there. I guess he also performed satirical cabarets, which sound awesome. Sign me up. Gruen and his wife, being of Jewish descent, he fled to America in 1938 and was a refugee from the Nazi-occupied Austria. Him and his wife fled with the help of a friend who drove them to the airport dressed as like an SS officer. Here in America, he would first build storefronts in New York City. Later, him and his wife would divorce. He would move to Los Angeles and try to join the army to fight in World War II, but was rejected. He founded his own firm in America and became a really big deal. Close to 15 years later, this is when the people of Minnesota asked him if he would like to build a shopping center in their state. So it's interesting that Gruen was picked because of some of his beliefs about the world at the time. For one, he really didn't like suburbanization because he felt it brought on social isolation, and another thing he really didn't like was cars. People were becoming more and more reliant on cars, and he said, quote, their threat to human life and health is just as great as the exposed sewer. But nonetheless, when he thought about building the shopping mall, he wasn't just thinking about consumerism, but he was also trying to build a community aspect that would benefit a healthier life. When I say community, his vision was just that, and when originally putting out the plans for it, he thought about the mall having schools, people living there, and a medical center, which I don't feel is so weird to think about. This was the 50s, and like if you look at Walt Disney, he kind of tried to do the same thing with Epcot being a community. As time went on, after he built this mall, he did not like what America did to his vision as other developers took suit and built malls all over America. He feels all of his community aspects were lost and it was only for retail. He was giving a speech in London in 1978 and said, quote, "I refuse to pay alimony for those bastard developments." Gruen moved back to Vienna in 1968 and passed away on February 14th, 1980. In a way, it kind of saddens me that he didn't really get to see what the malls did in the 80s or 90s for families, as I felt like it was the closest era of community that they had for teenagers being able to do stuff and just other family members. It kind of was a community, so he kind of missed that. Now, after the opening years of Southdale Center, it has had many changes throughout the long, still active retail heaven. Like I said, when they open with two different anchor stores, those being Dayton's and Donaldson's. But in later years, there was some hubbub that a new department store wanted to join in on the fun at Southdale. And in 1972, a new 247,000 square foot anchor was constructed, making it the third anchor. And the store is JCPenney. I wanted to pick a store in the first episode that everyone has heard of and give some history. In future episodes, I might pick more obscure ones, but who doesn't have some fabulous memories at Penny's, right? So JCPenney is an American retail company and was founded in 1902 by a man named James Cash Penney. Now you can really annoy your friends and start saying, "Oh, hey, you want to go to James Cash Penney's place and get some new jeans?" It's known for selling apparel, home furnishings, jewelry, cosmetics, and cookware. From 1913 to 1924, it was called JCPenney Stores Company, and after that, it turned into JCPenney's Co., which maybe people said company, but when I was reading it, it just said Co. Then in 1968, it was when they changed it to simply JCPenney. So it started out as a place called Golden Rule Dry Goods Store in 1902. And at that time, Penney had two other partners. They opened some other stores. Then he bought out those partners and took on some new partners. When the name changed in 1913, he and his partners already had 34 stores. And this was mainly all in the West. By 1929, they had 1,392 stores. So they were some busy dudes building some stores. I guess Mr. Penney had some strict rules and policies if you worked at his store. If you smoked or drank, even in the privacy of your own home and someone found out, you were terminated, just fired right then. Penney finally retired in 1946. In 1958, the store started letting you purchase things on store credit cards. Penney's also got into the mail order sales, with their first catalog being distributed in 1963. If you grew up even later than that, getting a catalog in the mail was always fun, especially around Christmas time. In 1968, they bought out a Belgian retail chain and opened its first international stores in Italy in 1971. It also opened stores in Mexico and Chile, but later it closed all their international division in 2003. So in 2006 is when they partnered up with Sephora, the cosmetic chain, and would have little Sephora stores within the store. The mall that I know has both a Sephora and one inside Penny's. With the rise of the internet, online sales was all the rage in the 2010s, so Penny's discontinued its mail order catalogs. Penny still stands as a retail chain, even with all its buddies dying in front of its eyes. I would like to know what you think. Will we have Penny's for our kids or for our grandkids or their grandkids? or will we be attending that funeral here real soon? I have Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, all at History of Malls, and you can email me at historyofmalls@gmail.com. I would love to know what you think about pennies. Back to the mall, there was other changes that happened to the Southdale Center during the years. Stores left or went out of business, such as Donaldson's in 1987. In 1991, Dayton's also left the mall, so they demolished that anchor and built new stores and even extended the Garden Court. The mall was sold to the O'Connor Group for $125 million, and maybe I'm just bad with how money is exchanged, but to me this seems like low for what this mall was. Around the same time, they converted the basement of the mall into a Marshalls, which I find fascinating for some reason. Just thinking of a Marshalls in a basement, it kind of works. Now in 2000, the mall did another bigger renovation. There had been competitions throughout the years, like in 1976 when another mall was built, the Galleria Edina right across the street. But with other malls and the actual Mall of America being right around in the same area, they needed to spruce it up to keep people in. They put in things like a 16-screen movie theater, an area of different restaurants like California Pizza Kitchen and the Cheesecake Factory, and they updated the third floor more focused towards teens. In the bad years for malls, Southdale had its issues like all others. One of their anchor stores in 2004 was Mervyn's, and it hurt them when they went out of business. Because of the closure, there was a ripple effect, and other stores left the mall, like Ritz Camera and Crate and Barrel. Like every mall, there was always events that went on. In 1985, a cardiologist named Dr. James Erdahl gave a riveting free seminar on stress tests. In 1988, when the brand new AT&T Phone Center opened, they had a sweepstakes. If you won the sweepstakes, you could pick between three prizes: a trip to the Grand Bahamas, $1,000 in cash, or a grandfather clock. And in 1991, Tony Bennett, yeah, that the Tony Bennett, appeared at the Wentworth Art Gallery to show off his artwork. I had no clue he painted, and when he paints, it's actually under his real name of Anthony Benedetto. There was kind of a lot of crime in and around the mall, which seemed to happen in a lot of malls. Nothing really, it's still safe in malls, but there's always crime. Like in 1985 in the Star Tribune, in the police report section, over half the things were at the mall, such as shoplifting, indecent exposure, and assault. One of them read, quote, "A 21-year-old man was arrested March 20th at JCPenney's Southdale Shopping Center for shoplifting fishing hooks valued at $4. That's something to get arrested for, is some fishing hooks for $4. In 2009, there was a gang-related shooting in the parking lot. Two boys were shot, one 15, one 18, but both survived. It's not a lot. It wasn't. For being open since 1956, it seemed like it was a good, safe mall. From their website, this mall is still going strong. And looking at all the stores in it, it has a lot of malls, which seem good, mall stores. With that said, in 2017, JCPenney said they would be closing 9 of their stores in Minnesota, and that was one of them. A Lifetime Fitness took over in its place. But yeah, that's the history of the Southdale Center. I'd like to thank you for listening. If you go to the Southdale Center, I would love a picture of the directory in the mall. I really want to have a collection of mall directories. You can take a selfie or just the directory or get all artsy with like a corn dog from Hot Dog on a Stick in front of it. I don't really care. I would just like a picture. You can send it to any of my social media page, such as Twitter, Instagram, or Facebook, all at History of Malls. Or if you just want to chat or suggest a mall for me to cover, you can get a hold of me there or my email at historyofmalls@gmail.com. So to end every episode, I hope to pick a different artist and a song that you might not know of. Tonight's episode is featuring the song Trip Chips by Creepy Pizza. Thanks again, and hope to hear from you soon.